Good morning and a warm welcome to the 8th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is a decision in taking business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 3 in private? Thank you very much. Our second agenda item is to continue to take evidence on our inquiry on how devolution is changing post-EU and how devolution should evolve to respond to the challenges and opportunities of the new constitutional landscape. Today we will be hearing from a panel of former senior civil servants, and we are joined this morning by Professor Hugh Rawlings, Dr. Andrew McCormick, Professor Jim Gallagher, CBFRSE, Paul Cackett, and Philip Rycroft, who is joining us remotely. And a warm welcome to you all. If I could begin by asking an opening question, and then we'll move to questions from the committee. But following the Internal Market Act, there has been impacts on devolution, and we would like to examine how a regulatory divergence can work within the new constitutional landscape, and how you think devolution has been impacted by the Internal Market Act. And if I could maybe, I'll go for, to Professor Rawlings first, please. Thanks.
Thank you, convener. It's a pleasure to be here on my first visit to the Parliament. I think the Internal Market Act had a profound impact because, as I can remind the committee, a couple of years before it was introduced, there had been a commitment on the part of the four administrations to enter into common frameworks which were designed explicitly to manage the possibility of regulatory divergence, providing machinery for discussion of prospective divergence, mechanisms for dealing with possible disputes and so forth. So this was designed or envisaged as a mechanism for joint regulation or joint management of the internal market by the four administrations working together in a collaborative way. The Internal Market Act, of course, cut straight across that. In its original form, it didn't acknowledge the existence of the common frameworks at all, and it was only as a result of amendments in the House of Lords that consideration was given to the impact of the Internal Market Act on the common frameworks. And of course, the Internal Market Act reflected a different conception of how the internal market should be used. It was agreed on all sides that there needed to be regulation of the internal market, but whereas the common framework, proceeded on the basis of a collaborative understanding of how the internal market should be managed, the Internal Market Act was a directive approach from the centre as to how internal markets should could work. And the amendments in the House of Lords were an attempt to mitigate the full rigour of that. So I think the question really is the extent to which the common frameworks can survive as a mechanism to provide for regulatory divergence. And I take the opportunity to remind the committee that the Office of the Internal Market, which was set up by the Internal Market Act, has an obligation to produce periodic reports on the impact or the development of the internal market and how common frameworks have impacted on it. And that the first report is due this month. It has to be published by the end of this month and will be laid in front of the Parliament as in front of the Senedd and at Westminster. So I think it will only be then that we will be able to see with that comprehensive assessment by the Office of the Internal Market, how exactly the flexibility provided by the common frameworks for regulatory divergence has survived the blunderbuss approach, if I might put it in those terms, of the Internal Market Act.
Thank you. Dr. McCormick.
Again, thank you for the welcome, and my first time in this Parliament. I appreciate the opportunity to engage with you. Some quite different and complicated considerations in relation to Northern Ireland. The issues around regulatory divergence had surfaced, of course, back at the very early stages of the process, including in the joint report of the negotiators in December 2017. That was the whole nature of what the May administration agreed. At that point, the hard question, and it remains the hard question, is how to reconcile Northern Ireland's place in the UK internal market with the absence of a land border and, as Michel Barnier put it back in April 18, if the land border is open, he said, then everything in Northern Ireland has to be single market compliant. Now, obviously, a lot of water has passed under the bridge since then. That's been the focus of both internal debate, including in the context, as I agree with everything that you have said, applies in some respects in Northern Ireland, so nothing to take away from all of that. But some very, very different considerations. And so just getting to the present day and Windsor Framework context, that takes us to a place where the relevance of that is how we'd cope with divergence in a different context to divergence between the different component parts of the United Kingdom, but how to cope with the complexities that could arise either through new EU regulations or ways in which the UK might diverge from EU standards. They present potential challenges, and there's an unevenness of risk in a certain sense. Let me put it this way, what the government has consistently guaranteed is that there's nothing in the way of the access of Northern Ireland produce into the UK internal market. That's so unfettered access, that critically important term, has always been clear and committed on a NI to GB context, and the Internal Market Act provisions affect that. What is not possible simply is the inverse, and that's where the complexities of the Windsor Framework, the Green Lane, Red Lane idea, all of those things come into play, and where then the Stormont break becomes relevant, because that's where if the effect of some change was to make that more complicated, and that's possibly significant, then what's the right thing to do? In the original protocol, there was a power for the UK government to deal with new EU legislation through the Joint Committee. The new provisions, the amendment that is actually going into the protocol, means that there will be the same check or a similar check can be applied if necessary to amending regulations. But it's important to consider possible effect of that. If not accepting an amended EU regulation is such that the EU needs to take action in relation to the integrity of the single market, it becomes a very uneven risk. Norway, Switzerland are in exactly the same position. They continually have to choose dynamic alignment, and they've chosen to do so. Indeed, they pay for the privilege because they regard that as in their economic interests. You could say that the same applies to Northern Ireland, and maybe under the original protocol that did apply. But if the difference, an important difference, is that we're part of the UK, and if the UK chooses to go a separate way, then there's or diverge materially in some way that would actually affect something significant, then there could be a real issue. And in that scenario, things become really quite complicated. So that's, as I said, quite a different set of issues. Indeed, this part of the Internal Market Act was not the focus for us in the autumn of 2020. There were notwithstanding clauses to be thought about, which are a whole different set of issues. But the principles, as you said, everything you said in principle is relevant, but we have all those different and quite complicated factors as well.
Thank you. Professor Gallagher?
Thank you, Convener. Unhappily, this is not my first time in front of a committee here, but it's always nice to be back. I don't want to repeat points which my colleagues have made, but broadly speaking, I would adopt what Hugh Rawlings said as a description. I think myself that the internal market legislation was an error, and that would have been possible, and actually in practice it will be possible, to deal with questions of regulatory divergence if there is the political will to do so between the respective governments. But it's important from a purely Scottish perspective to remember that the internal market of the UK does matter for Scotland, and that regulatory divergence for its own sake isn't something to be sought out just because you can do it. The question is what you're seeking to achieve. And what's quite interesting for me in that context is that it is actually possible to run an effective market with well-managed regulatory divergence. We managed it for approximately 300 years. That was the whole point. The economic union nevertheless managed to sustain, for example, a separate Scottish legal system. And I can imagine that if the proposition of this Parliament to its colleagues in Westminster was that there should be a Scottish separate legal system, there would be the most awful shout of, my goodness, you can't possibly do that. So divergence, it can be managed, but it needs to be managed carefully and properly. A constant focus on the principles, on standing on one's dignity, is not the way to do that. One has to look at actual practical issues as they emerge. If this is about the content of sausages, let's negotiate about the content of sausages, not about abstract constitutional principles. If we do that, and in the way in which Hugh described, which is collaboratively, that these issues are entirely manageable. The more people stand on high horses, the harder they will be to manage. However, there is one area where I would stand on my high horse, and that is that this intervention by the UK government at the time, the internal market legislation, was, as the committee will well understand, a breach of the Sewell Convention. That was, in my view, an error, and it is of constitutional significance. I won't repeat the history of the Sewell Convention and the significance of it, but the consequence, in my view, of this particular and a couple of other interventions by recent UK governments, it does, I think, leave the argument for strengthening the Sewell Convention unanswerable. And you may or may not want to go into that issue in this committee, but it's one that needs to be registered in this debate. And I've given you a short note which explains precisely how that should be done. And it is my hope that that will be the policy of an incoming administration in Westminster.
Thank you. It's something we have done some considerable work on in this committee, and also in conjunction with our colleagues in the other devolved legislatures as well, who I would say are equally affected by what's happened with Sewell. So thank you for that. Mr. Cackett, am I pronouncing that properly?
Cackett, yes, but Cackett. Emphasis.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Thank you.
And I also, like Jim, have appeared before committees of this nature a number of times in the past, so it's good to be back. I think my response in this would be to look at this from the perspective of intergovernmental relations, which is an interest of mine in this context. And I would agree with what Hugh says about the impact on common frameworks. You've received evidence and papers from Michael Keating about the intergovernmental relations and the purpose of it. And in answer to your question, I would just add a little bit to what Professor Keating said. He talked in terms of intergovernmental relations needing a proper structure to support joint working and to ensure dispute resolution. I would add a third to that, and that would be complementary policy making, because not all policies are jointly agreed, not all policies are intended to work the same way throughout the UK. In some ways, the concept of joint policy making had a resonance, particularly when the UK were part of the EU, when the UK were the member state and Scottish civil servants, including myself, contributed to a unified UK line. But I draw that distinction because I think it is important to recognise that it was part of the issue of recognising the respect that different administrations should have for each other's discretion and the discretion of parliaments to make their own decisions in their own geographical area and within their own competences, is that intergovernmental relations should be developed in such a way that leaves a space for complementary policy making, whereby we recognise that in our respective geographical areas we can make our own policies, but that the benefits of consistency within the UK can be achieved through that kind of level of joint working. And that's where I think probably my comment on specifically on the Internal Market Act is that that's an area of work that still really hasn't worked perhaps as effectively as it could be. I know there are systems put in place for ministerial disagreements, but to me there's a bit of consideration of work to be done in terms of civil service cooperation and indeed scrutiny by respective parliaments and assemblies.
And indeed, again, scrutiny is something that's been of concern for the committee as well. And finally, Mr. Rycroft, please.
Good morning, and thank you, convener. And sorry not to be with you this morning. I'm over in the west of Scotland today. Not a huge amount to add. I think there's been a good coverage of the question already, with much of which I agree with. Maybe just a couple of reflections. First off, management of an internal market is important. Divergence can be expensive, and it can be expensive for businesses, and it can disrupt supply chains and ultimately reduce choice for consumers. If you want any evidence of that, just look what's happening at the moment vis-a-vis the UK and the wider EU. Just one small example of that, the UK setting up its own regime on chemicals, suppliers of chemicals ultimately having to retest their product for the UK market. There will be some suppliers from the continent who will say that is simply not worth our while, we are no longer going to supply that market. So divergence matters. It matters for the flow of business and ultimately for prosperity. But the question is, how do you manage an internal market? And in this context, in the UK, was the UK Internal Market Act necessary to manage the UK internal market? I agree with what's been said already. We had a mechanism through the common frameworks to deal with those domains where there were cross-border issues, where divergent regimes may have caused problems either side of those borders. And I have yet to see any evidence that suggests that the common frameworks weren't going to be adequate to deal with those issues. So the UK Internal Market Act in this context, I think, was a step too far. But it just, if you would allow me, just to give rise to one sort of slightly broader issue. Why? Why did the UK government feel that it was necessary to go down this track? And just one reflection then on the process we're going through post-Brexit. Brexit, of course, was ultimately about returning sovereignty to the UK from Brussels, the rehoming of that sovereignty. If that's what you've been driving at if that's what is, in a sense, the motivating purpose of your administration, getting that sovereignty back doesn't put in a frame of mind then to want to share that sovereignty further within the United Kingdom. And you see that tension, I think, still in UK government policy between those who are saying, this is our opportunity to reassert the sovereignty of the UK Parliament, to assert the concept of a unitary state on the one hand, and others who are saying, no, we still need to manage devolution in the way that we've got used to. We need good intergovernmental relations and the rest of it. And I think that tension is still very evident in the approach of the UK government to these issues. And I think it was the assertive side of that that was responsible ultimately for the UK Internal Market Act.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee. Can we bring in Mr. Cameron first?
Thank you very much, convener, and good to see you all. I'm so glad to hear such enthusiasm for appearing in front of Scottish parliamentary committees. You obviously haven't been given a hard enough time by MSPs. I've got a couple of questions. I'm very interested just on that last point by Philip Rycroft. I mean, I acknowledge that, but there is, especially around the internal market, there were commercial, economic reasons that I think it is easy to downplay. And I just wondered if you had any view or observation on the kind of economic reasoning behind the Internal Market Act, because I think it shouldn't be ignored, notwithstanding the very compelling points you've just made.
I'll bring in Mr. Rycroft first. I think he's having problems with the mic.
No, I'm here.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, good. So, no, very happy to respond to that. As I said at the start of my remarks, absolutely understanding the commercial reality, how internal markets function, how business can flow through that internal market with a minimum of hindrance to delivering goods and products across that market, and ultimately the prosperity for everybody in that market. How you achieve that clearly does require management, and it requires a deep understanding of the needs of business. And therefore, when you're looking at possible divergence, part of the equation has to be, what will that mean for the effective delivery of business both sides of that border? Now, one solution to that would be, one government saying, well, we'd quite like to legislate in order to require producers to do a certain thing, label their products in a particular way, and deal, with the chain of waste in a particular way, whatever it may be, then if you then have different rules either side of the border, that clearly adds cost to business. If you have to run a separate labelling line to supply a small market, there comes a point where it's simply not worth doing that, because the cost of putting that extra label on your bottle of jam or whatever it may be is too great for the size of the market you're supplying. So one solution to that, of course, is, well, agreement that everybody changes. That's ultimately what the EU single market was about. It was about reducing 28 sets of laws to one set of laws, which would then allow those businesses to function. Now, the same clearly applies within the UK context as well. And when governments are thinking about changes, whether it's for public health, environmental reasons, or whatever it may be, part of the consideration must be the impact on the cost of doing business. And there will be occasions where governments decide, and under devolved powers, rightly so, that the benefit of that change outweighs the cost. But in many other circumstances, the answer, if there is a public good to be derived from that legislation, is to do it in common. How do you do that successfully? You negotiate as through the common frameworks, or what we experienced up till a couple of years ago through negotiations of single market concepts in the EU. We know how to do this. The best way forward is through negotiation and collaboration to deliver ultimately the public good.
Thank you very much. Yes,
of course. I mean, I absolutely agree with Philip's analysis, and I think it's very important to distinguish the need to sustain a market for the benefit of the people who get the services and the products, and the question of who has the authority to make the rules. And the danger, and Philip's description was absolutely correct in his first answer, that one confuses the two and thinks that since it is a UK market, only a UK government can make the decisions. And this goes back, Philip said the magic S word, so I shall repeat it. This goes back to this question and obsession with the idea of sovereignty. Sovereignty is a concept which should be put in the bin. It is not a useful way of allocating powers and responsibilities across multi-level governments. And it's a mistaken confusion of the correct assertion that there is a UK single or domestic market, as I would rather call it, which requires to be preserved, and the notion that sovereign power must therefore reside at a particular level. And so we need to disentangle those two things, separate the politics and the economics.
I'm very glad you made that point, because it also emphasises that we look at this sometimes just in terms of the UK and Scotland. But there are issues between Wales and Scotland, Northern Ireland and Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. I mean, and I think that often that analysis gets lost within this discussion. Can I move on to a different issue? You've touched on Sewell already, Jim, but I think my question is this. Our inquiry is about the effects of Brexit on devolution, and we are all aware of some very high-profile cases where this Parliament has not given consent to post-Brexit legislation. What I'm asking is, does the panel think that it is the political tensions and pressures that we're all aware of that occurred before, during and after Brexit that has led to these problems? Or have we been incubating these issues since actually 1999? And I ask that question in the knowledge that all of you have a very strong track record in working the civil service of in throughout devolution. I'd be very grateful for your views. Could I start with Paul Kerr, please?
Yes, that point, I think, about the incubation of the problem, I think, is absolutely right. One of the reflections I have is that, well, Brexit has in many ways changed everything in the kind of the way we look at these issues. We are in a very different environment, partly political, but also partly in terms of the culture exhibited by civil servants and by politicians in the early days of devolution. And there was very much a drive at that point, as the Scottish Parliament was established, to help it bed in and to make it work. And there's very much a culture. I remember going back to the days of Donald Dewar and Tony Blair, who were very keen to ensure that at that stage that the Parliament was made to be a success. And, of course, the political synergy between the administrations in Edinburgh and London certainly helped in that respect. What's very different now is that devolution has bedded in, and we are now very much at a stage where that desire to make it work and to look at things in that way has very much changed. And I think the other kind of wider angle to all of this, beyond again Brexit, is the increasing complexity of administration throughout the UK. We not only have the three devolved administrations, but a London administration, the metropolitan mayors, the areas of England that don't have metropolitan mayors, and certainly in my experience, I latterly was a director with various COVID responsibilities, so I was closely involved in some of the development of work there, and the ways in which different responses were necessary, in particular. Andy Burnham, for example, was a very prominent speaker about the interests of Greater Manchester. And that too has added to the complexity of how we have to face these issues. So yes, it's Brexit, but it's also the fact that it's a maturing and bedded in Parliament here and assemblies elsewhere, changing obviously as time has gone by over time in other places. And I think it is important when looking at these wider issues as to the future of devolution to recognise that the various solutions that have been adopted and the solution that's been adopted most frequently in trying to address concerns of the right balance in devolution is increasing powers, and more powers have been given over time. And a question in my mind, particularly in a post-Brexit environment, as to whether that's the right model going forward or whether they need to think differently, which may be around questions of shared competency. The Internal Markets Act may not be the best example of successful shared competence, but I was interested in Professor McEwen's report she prepared, I think, for the Devolution Committee back in 2015, where she noted that the UK sits quite far down compared to many other states in the extent to which regional assemblies and parliaments have shared competencies with the national parliaments. And it may well be there's some scope there to be thinking in terms of a genuine shared competency as a way forward.
I'll just go down the line, Professor Gallagher.
I think that's it's a really interesting and important question. And inevitably, because I'm a civil servant still, I'm going to tell you it's a bit one and a bit the other. I think it's quite an important issue. This takes us into the nature of the UK's constitution and the extent to which it is written down in black letter law or not. And the UK's constitution has traditionally relied very substantially on conventions and expectations and norms which can be unkindly called the good chap theory of government. That has had to face up to the enormous eruption of Brexit, which is anything but normal, as has been noted in the Sewell context. And it has been stretched to, and in my view, beyond breaking point by that. A result of that is that we are going to have to crystallise in law more things than we've found it necessary to crystallise in law in the past. When we reach the stage when the Supreme Court twice overturns the actions of a UK government in its relationship with Parliament, clearly something has gone wrong in our constitutional setup. And similarly, when we reach the stage when the Civil Convention is unnecessarily, in my view, breached in the context of Brexit. Well, it's perhaps not surprised, but it does say that something needs to be done. And more of our constitutional arrangements need to be crystallised, and more explicit explanation of the relative balance of power and the management of the relationships between the different levels of government. The UK has for a century or more seen itself as a unitary state, even while it has acted as a quasi-federal state in respect of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. We need to shift that, and more of our rules need to be put into forms where the courts can, if necessary, adjudicate upon them. Good fences make good neighbours.
Thank you. Dr. McCormick?
I can say that the devolution settlement in Northern Ireland was far from comfortable or settled or resolved before Brexit came along, but Brexit has changed things fundamentally. So some obvious points from a Northern Ireland point of view, Good Friday Agreement is not just a devolution settlement, it's a constitutional settlement relating to, it's an international agreement with Ireland. It settled for the first time the constitutional status of Northern Ireland on a basis that could be supported across the island, and that was part of a resolution and an accommodation between traditions that overturned. Actually, you can trace it back to the 1918 general election. I can give you lots of history if you want it, but certainly it's a different status, and what that means is that the nature of the relationships between Northern Ireland, Ireland as a continuing member state, and the rest of the UK were thrown into unique tensions which have not been resolved, which is why we don't have devolution up and running. That links to promises made or alleged to have been made when the ministers last came back in January 2020 through what was called New Decade, New Approach. But yet what we have now and what was in the protocol bill, which I find quite astounding, was a reference to the Act of Union, which it has a provision about trade, but was part of the unification of the United Kingdom, which the Good Friday Agreement resolving the tension that had been there between the Act of Union of 1800 and the Home Rule Campaign, Government of Ireland Act. All of that very complicated, unresolved history was resolved constitutionally and received overwhelming support in 1998, and Brexit disturbed that balance. And the reason it did that is because there was an assertion of constitutional sovereignty by the UK as a unit, where the Good Friday Agreement said the constitutional future of Northern Ireland is a matter for the people of Northern Ireland. Indeed, then that's clear in the very first page of the Good Friday Agreement, which also commits the UK government to behaving with rigorous impartiality between the two main traditions in Northern Ireland. So very, very different contexts and circumstances, very disturbing to the settlement, and so the important thing, the positive thing maybe emerging from rapprochement between UK and EU is a chance to return to the fundamentals of that settlement, which are power sharing. Again, this is different but relevant. Different because it affects how these things work. Power sharing, North-South relations, equality, consent, those fundamentals stand, and then Northern Ireland's relationship in terms of trade and goods has to be unique, and does affect then the balance of relationships with the other parts of the UK. So it's complicated.
Thank you. Professor Rawlings.
Well, thank you. It's as Jim has said, the question actually is really quite a fundamental one. It seems to me that Brexit is both the cause but also the context of your inquiry. I think one of the things that we've learned from Brexit, and you know, I freely confess that I hadn't appreciated it before, even though I was doing devolution from 1999 onwards, was the extent to which we assumed, without thinking any further, membership of the EU as a framework within which devolution could work. So that external mechanism for holding devolution together was then withdrawn. But what I think we're now also realising is that devolution depends at a fundamental level on understandings of trust between governments. There was a reference earlier to shared governance. Well, shared governance has been a theme, or was a theme certainly when I was there, and I think it has continued, of the Welsh Government fairly soon after the Brexit referendum took place. In fact, we published a document, I'm going to wave it for the camera, called Reforming Our Union, Shared Governance in the UK, and that was published in as early as 2018, and there has been a second version of it. And certainly the view that the Welsh Government took at that time was, and this of course was consistent with the idea of the Common Frameworks, that we had to reinforce the collaborative possibilities of devolution to compensate, in a way, for the fact that the external framework of the EU had been withdrawn. But the problem, of course, is that Brexit has dissolved many of the bounds of trust between the administrations. And so that is the context of this inquiry. And so where do we go if we have limited trust and limited commitment to shared governance as a matter of political reality? Then perhaps it has, and the question is to the extent this is possible, the question is how far it can be mandated. And that means replacing understandings, conventions, good chap theory of governance with a measure of juridification, the replacement of political norms by legal norms. Now, from a small jurisdiction standpoint, actually, conceptually, a system based on, or a rules-based system, is going to be preferable to a system based on discretion, because the discretion tends to be exercised by the largest and most powerful party in the system. So from that point of view, a rules-based system, greater juridification of the constitution, the replacement of political norms by legal norms, would be beneficial certainly to some of the smaller jurisdictions within the UK. But of course it would come at a cost, and it brings questions of the extent to which you want the courts involved in regulating relations between governments.
And finally, Philip.
Hi, thank you. Just to come back to your original question, was there something incubating pre-2016? Was there something lurking in the system that was, if you like, would have emerged whether it had Brexit or not? All I can say is it didn't feel like that at the time. So I was running the UK governance group in the Cabinet Office from in 2015, 2016, had been doing, had those responsibilities through the last 3 years of the coalition government as well. And it's just worth remembering what we were doing before the EU referendum. My team was partly designing the bill to allow the referendum to happen, but that was slightly by the by. We were completing at that point the Scotland Act, what became the Scotland Act 2016. And what that Act did, as we all know, further fiscal powers, welfare powers, the Scottish Parliament, putting Sewell on the face of statute, even though it was not justiciable. We were also in the midst of a review of intergovernmental relations. This had come out of the learnings, if you like, of the Scottish referendum campaign, how that had impacted Whitehall, had impacted relations between the UK government and the devolved governments. So there was a lot going on to try and firm up the devolution settlements, to extend them. A sense that there was a job there to be done to complete what had been set off in 1999. Particularly in relation to fiscal powers and welfare powers for Scotland. That was very much the tenor of the government that I was working for at the time. It was the Cameron government, obviously, of 2015. And there was no hint amongst the ministers I worked for, no hint at all of this sort of more assertive, muscular unionism, if I could characterise it like that, that has emerged since then. So that's what that was the departure point, if you like, for the handling, the dealing with Brexit. The sort of the washout of that, I think, into the early time in Brexit was an endeavour to seek to manage the Brexit process in a way that sustained an optimal level of collaboration across the four governments of the UK. We did set up something called the Joint Ministerial Committee subgroup to look at European negotiations with quite an expansive remit, which was a very deliberate attempt to ensure that through this, what was going to be an enormously difficult passage, that at least the relationships between the two governments, the governments could be effectively managed. It simply didn't work out as it intended. And that fractured and frayed more and more as time went on. So I think from my perspective, you have to see Brexit as a breakpoint in all sorts of way, but including in the management of relations between the four governments of the United Kingdom. And I would agree what's been said, this has been so significant that I don't think there is no going back to the status quo ante. It does require a reconfiguration, a reconceptualisation of how those relations are managed.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Dr. Allen?
If I may turn to the retained EU law bill, if that's not too drastic a gear change. I'm interested to know opinions, perhaps starting with Mr. Rycroft, but others too, about how that bill is going to impact on government time. We've talked a bit in this committee about how it will affect us as a legislature and some of the issues of principle. That doesn't sound like I'm on a high horse. But how will it affect, what planning is being done to cope with the enormous task that seems to be envisaged in that piece of legislation over the next few months?
Well, clearly I'm no longer in the House, so can't give you a sort of direct answer to that, what's happening in Whitehall. What I can say is from what I know about the challenge of managing the transition post-Brexit in terms of the UK statute book, that the EU retained law bill, it seems to me, is seeking to do the impossible. I cannot see how the UK government has the legislative, the time, the space to work through this great body of law in good order to allow sensible decision making on what should apply and what should not apply. It's not. Ultimately, you can abstract this, it seems to me, from the ideological question of, as to whether there should be a residue of EU law on the UK statute book. If you think what so much of this law is doing, it is governing how businesses function, how the law works in 101 fairly humdrum areas, some more important than others. But it impacts on a myriad of businesses, organisations, us as individuals, as consumers, as employees and all the rest of it. The way you make good regulation, good legislation, is you do that through a process of engagement, consultation, understanding the interests of different parties in relation to that regulation. There is simply not time and space to do that. So, frankly, words almost failed me in respect of this bill. It does seem to me it is seeking to do the impossible. And in and amongst its impacts, of course, is the impact on the devolved competences in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. And untangling all of that in the time that is available again, seems to me to be asking too much. It is an extraordinary piece of legislation that they're embarked on, and one which I see very, very little benefit in.
Thank you. That was pretty comprehensive. The others wish to come in? Professor Rawlings first. I'm looking at the convener here, but Professor Rawlings.
Sorry. Thank you. it is, as Philip said, an extraordinary piece of legislation, and he said he's lost for words. Well, I mean, I'm well retired from the civil service now, so I can speak frankly. This is an exercise in performative government. This is, it is a perfectly reasonable policy aim to review EU-derived law as policies come up for re-examination and reconsideration, and the extent to which you need to maintain rules which in their origin came from membership of the EU. But what we're faced with here is to complete all this work in theory by the end of 2023. I don't think we need to be mealy-mouthed about why the end of 2023. There's going to be a general election in 2024, and the existing UK government will want to be able to say, we have got Brexit done, look, we've dealt with all this legislation. But it is a wholly unworkable timetable. One of the Whitehall departments most impacted by this, probably the one most impacted, is DEFRA. And it was very interesting to see, of course, the House of Lords is taking committee stage on this bill at the moment, and it was very interesting to read some of the debates. And the DEFRA minister in the House of Lords last week appeared to say that DEFRA's default position is that the existing regulations should stay, and that he expected that to be the outcome of the reviews. That that DEFRA has well over 1,000 regulations to examine, and that this would be a process, apparently, in which they would all be reviewed, and then the bulk of them would be retained. This doesn't seem to be the most sensible way of conducting government. And of course, the problem with it is that the bill's position is that the default position is that the regulations fall away. They have to be saved if they're going to be saved. So, to answer directly your question, like Philip, I'm no longer involved in the government, and I don't know what planning work has been done. I understand that you had Hugh Iranka Davis as one of your witnesses last week. I imagine that Hugh was pretty clear about the horrors which are faced by the Senedd in dealing with this legislation. Of course, there is scope in the bill, in Clause 2, to extend the deadline from 2023 in respect of certain categories of regulation, or indeed individual regulations, to give them more time to review them. The date chosen for the possible extension is the 23rd of June 2026. And it was pointed out in the House of Lords. What account, when this provision was drafted, what consultation was there had with the devolved administrations and the devolved legislatures? You are aware, are you not, Minister, that there will be elections in May 2026, that the Senedd and the Scottish Parliament will rise at the end of March 2026, and that therefore they can't possibly be undertaking work up until June the 23rd, 2026. Why was that date chosen? Well, the Minister said, in an admission of this is performative government, it just happens to be 10 years from the date of the referendum, and by implication, no, we didn't give a moment's thought to the devolved institutions, their elections, and how they might do this. So I'm sorry if I have overstepped the mark, but it's something I feel really quite strongly about, This is an appalling piece of legislation, and certainly I think in terms of what I have said and in terms of the powers that it confers on ministers to change the law in respect of a category of regulation that the government is incapable of defining. It simply doesn't know how far this goes. This makes a mockery of taking back control and asserting parliamentary sovereignty. This is about ministerial lawmaking of an extraordinary scale, and it's constitutionally wholly, utterly inappropriate.
Thank you, Professor Rawlings. Does anyone else wish to come in? I'm just going through the convener as well. Andrew McCormack, want to come in?
Just very briefly, because again, I'm retired and not on top of these issues in detail. I think, thinking of it from a point of view of principle, what my former colleagues in the Northern Ireland Civil Service need to be focusing on is the implications of how evolving EU law will affect Northern Ireland under the Windsor framework and how that works out. That's going to be a new and very demanding task, because Whitehall did all that while we were a member state, and will no longer be. They'll be not only not interested, but probably under instruction not to be interested, because that's the old way and this is the new way. But that's where the implications for Northern Ireland will lie and where difficult issues will lie. Alongside that, having to both understand both the implications of existing law, what does retained EU law mean now, and which of those remain under the Protocol Windsor framework, and which of them are separate from that and in the area of other aspects of the economy, and then seeing, well, what is going to be the impact if this bill goes through? Those are three enormous tasks combined together. For me, the most important one for our people will be the future, rather than anything to do with this, which I have to say, agree with everything Philip and Hugh have said about the nonsensical nature of it as a process.
And Professor Gallagher?
I won't let off steam, but I agree with my colleagues. However, the question is, what is to be done about it? It seems quite likely that this law will be pursued by the present administration in London. There are three possibilities, it seems to me. The first is it's time for the House of Lords to earn their corn. The House of Lords can delay legislation. The last time they got so excited about delaying legislation was in relation to fox hunting. This matters a bit more. So 2 years would be fine, thank you. Even 1 year would help. That's the first possibility. The second possibility is that, and this is a much more political one, the opposition should set out its position on what it will do if it becomes the government and this law has passed. And that position might well be that a set of retrospective legislation should be prepared to give persons certainty of what happens on one electoral outcome. Third possibility, which relates to this institution and indeed to the Senate in Wales, is that two can play at that game. And what we've seen is a piece of legislation which disapplies all sorts of laws. Well, you could have one that reapplies them. Holus bolus. So it's time for a bit of imagination, because it's a piece of nonsense.
I too am no longer privy to recent thinking in dealing with these issues. But I'm going to make two points, thinking back to my time as Director of Legal Services in the Scottish Government at the pre-transition period when there was a significant amount of work that required to be done and legislation put before the Parliament to bring the Scottish devolved statute book into as much alignment as was necessary at that particular point. My two points are first of all, I know there was a protocol agreed between the Scottish Government and the Parliament in terms of change committee procedures and processes for addressing those. I would not really commend that system as being a particularly desirable way to scrutinise these matters. I'm reluctant to speak from behalf of parliamentarians who can speak for themselves, but it didn't seem to me that the time and the processes that were initiated there gave enough opportunities for proper scrutiny. It felt, from a governmental point of view, looking in to parliamentary scrutiny, as if parliamentarians were really faced with little choice as to what to do because of the pressure of time. And it didn't look to me as if that was a very effective way of scrutinising matters. From the governmental point of view, and specifically, as I say, of the legal directorate, it did put intense pressure in that period and led to a dilemma for me having to manage limited resources. We did get some extra resource at the time, but inexperienced lawyers coming in who don't know the government legal service, it was effectively an impossible task to ask them to be going in with no background experience to be drafting legislation of this sort of nature. And so the dilemma there for me was whether I'd say to ministers who were trying to advance their own programme for government and legislation that they can't have that delivered because I'm having to reassign staff to do other work in relation to a policy that the current elected administration does not support and is not in favour of. So I sympathise with my successors in office if they have to face those similar difficulties. But that was the acuteness of the dilemma. What do you do with your experienced staff who've got the skills to do these things, even if you do use all efforts you can get? And we brought people in from private firms to deal with some of the business of government at that time, but they didn't have the experience in legislation, so it put acute pressure certainly on the legal team at that time, and it certainly is something that I guess is under anxious and careful scrutiny by those with responsibility for those matters right now.
Thank you, Convener.
Ms Boyack. Much, Convener. It's been really insightful hearing the collective experience and the different perspectives that you've all given us this morning, so that's very much welcome. I want to go back to the opening comments about the impact of Brexit and devolution and what needs to be fixed. And I'm just thinking through from Jim Gallagher, your paper, there's a really interesting phrase, constitutional carelessness. William Ragg, a committee convener last week, said it's politics. And Philip Rycroft, you said this morning, it's the way we've got used to working. But in a sense, how do we move from here, where we feel it's not working, to a system that will work? So I was kind of keen to get your perspectives on what would be your priority. I mean, in the evidence we've had change in how the governments work together. Should they have to work together? Dispute resolution, what would that look like? Entrenched SEWL, that's been suggested. Inter-parliamentary work. What would be your kind of priorities? How do you incentivise respect to make devolution work? You've been on the inside from the civil service, but if it's too difficult, you don't need to answer my question. But I'm thinking of practically, how do we move on from here? What are the solutions that we should be looking at as a committee to actually generate a bit of progress here? And I'm not sure who I want to come in first. Who looks most nervous about this? trying to be constructive here, get solutions. So who would like to kick off? Andrew, do you want to kick off?
I'd like to kick off, because this is really, really important, and we won't get devolution back without restoration of some kind of effective working relationships, rebuilding of trust. I think the word carelessness is a word I've used in commenting on how the Brexit settlement for Northern Ireland was developed. It actually what happened in October 2019 and even right through to 2020 did not have serious regard for the impact of the decisions that were being taken by the Johnson administration for Northern Ireland's constitutional position. That's very, very evident. So how do you deal with that? In our context, the paragraph I keep going back to is paragraph 1.5 in the Good Friday Agreement, which involves commitment by the parties to work together, acknowledging their differences, acknowledging their totally divergent worldviews between Irish republicanism and unionism, but yet committing to make the institutions work. So, you know, naively, a commitment to work together, a commitment that, we have massive political differences, but making the institutions work. The Good Friday Agreement was both solving a constitutional problem and working out how to run a place, how to make decisions. And it wasn't about making better decisions or having slick and smooth government. It was about legitimacy and confidence. And that's still the issue in the Northern Ireland context. It sounds from all I'm hearing this morning that there are issues of legitimacy and confidence that apply, and there are different possible constitutional solutions to that. But actually saying, if you've got something which the people have voted for, if you've got something that is fixed, then let there be a commitment to make it work and engage together. That means honesty. And we don't have a government because there was serious issues of dishonesty around the explanation of what was agreed in 2019. That's right at the heart of why we have a problem. Dealing with that, facing up to those issues, getting into a rebuilding of trust, a recognition of different points of view, and saying, well, let's move forward together. That's idealistic, but you know, without some motivation like that, how do we go forward?
Yeah, thanks. And Professor Rawlings, do you want to come in?
Thank you. I can see that in the Northern Ireland case that a requirement that the various parties must commit to working together might have a important part to play in the restoration of devolution. At a more general level, however, and with all respect to Jim Gallagher, I have considerable doubts about mandating a duty of proper collaboration as a matter of law. So is there an alternative way? Well, my view on this has actually changed 180 degrees. When we were doing intergovernmental relations in the early years, it was clear there was a problem, but my view was that what you had to do was to improve the political culture around the operation of intergovernmental relations. And then, if once that had been done, if you wanted to reinforce that or buttress that with some form of legislation, then perhaps that, okay, you could do that. But the key thing was culture. But over the years, I came to the view that the culture wasn't going to change, that there was, and as Philip referred to it in an earlier answer, profound ambivalence on the part of the UK government as to the extent to which the other administrations had a legitimate part to play in the governance of the UK. And without that shared understanding of what the roles of the various administrations could be, then you were not likely to get productive intergovernmental relations. And indeed, they seemed to depend on the goodwill or absence of it of individual players within the UK government. And I think it's been a matter of record that when Damian Green and then Sir David Lidington came into the relevant jobs in Whitehall, there was a significant improvement in the nature of the relationships between the UK government and the devolved administrations, just because of the approach that they took and their attitudes to it. But then, of course, in what became the political shambles of last summer, the whole IGR system went into deep freeze because the UK government of the day simply refused to engage at all. And you all remember the case of when Prime Minister Truss refused to talk to the administrations. And, of course, throughout his 3 years, Mr Johnson refused to chair a meeting of the Joint Ministerial Council, which had previously been a central part of the intergovernmental relations arrangements. So this has led me to think now that at least at some level you do need to have a legal framework requiring the establishment of machinery for intergovernmental relations. Now, that doesn't have to be a sort of a detailed framework, but I think having an obligation on the four administrations to participate in regular intergovernmental meetings may be a useful starting point. And, you know, one hopes that if they, you know, meetings became part of business as usual in the conduct of government, the political culture of collaboration might develop from that. And so that's why I say I'm sort of now starting about, you may need law first and the culture will follow, rather than change the culture and then maybe do law. So I'm now in the place of, you may need to legislate for a system of intergovernmental relations. Because, sorry, now I'll finish at this point. Devolution implies the possibility of divergence. For divergence, if you're going to have divergence, you need reconciliation of different standpoints. That requires effective intergovernmental relations. Intergovernmental relations cannot depend on the goodwill or otherwise of the relevant actors at a given time. They have to be they have to recognise that this is part of the job which they have to do. It's business as usual to work with the other administrations.
Supplementary from Mr Cameron on to Professor Rawlings.
Very clear views on the personalities and politicians involved, good and bad. To what extent is culture an issue in terms of civil servants, especially in Whitehall, and relations between civil servants in Whitehall and devolved administrations?
It was an issue, and Philip Rycroft will be able to talk a lot about attitudes in Whitehall because it was part of his job to improve them. My job title was Director of Constitutional Affairs and Intergovernmental Relations. We saw intergovernmental relations as central to the conduct of constitutional affairs. That's where the Welsh Government was. At the expense of being slightly controversial, what I would say about intergovernmental relations was that within the UK was that the Welsh Government was the only administration which was wholeheartedly in favour of them working effectively. For perfectly understandable reasons, colleagues in Northern Ireland there were divergences of view within the executive as to how, what the relation should be within the UK. Within the Scottish Government, clearly the long-term constitutional aspirations of the Scottish Government would have meant that good intergovernmental relations would have been less of a priority, perhaps, than other, than a different view. And as Philip has said, there was profound ambivalence within the UK government as to what should be the legitimate role of the devolved administrations in the governance of the United Kingdom. Now, those differing political attitudes were bound to feed into civil service relationships. And although too much of commentary about IGR has tended to focus on the political actors, and there hasn't been enough recognition of the day-to-day business of exchange between civil servants, which for a long time worked perfectly well under the counter, as it were. My impression is that the impact of recent years' developments has made those relationships professionally rather more difficult than they used to be.
Ms Boyack, the other panel members want to respond to Ms Boyack. Yes, Ms Kikett.
I agree with much as what's been said. I would start by recognising that the issues and the challenges are formidably difficult to address, both from the civil service point of view, but also with enhanced scrutinies by the Parliament. The amount of effort and endeavour that would require to go in to having an effective system is pretty enormous. The civil servants can only, of course, act within the authority their ministers give them. But I think both within the Scottish Government and also, I suspect, Whitehall as well, there are different parameters and pressures that create difficulties making for effective intergovernmental relations. And they can probably all be summed up effectively in the concept of bandwidth. I've mentioned already the challenges that I see for Whitehall civil servants coping with a number of different devolution settlements, but even for Scottish civil servants as well, the pressure that's under, whether it be legislative or otherwise, to put legislation through, the focus is always on this place, rightly so, and on stakeholder engagement. It's Scottish devolution that we're delivering, and so wider implications and the extent to which there is an ability to look beyond to think of the implications elsewhere, or even to think of how implementation is going to work, which can be certain issues can arise in certain bills as to make that effective once it the bill leaves here can be extremely challenging. Philip will know more, and again, my experience is now slightly elderly, but I have to say my experience of dealing with Whitehall civil servants is that it's very mixed in many ways, but sometimes I've heard circumstances where they are extraordinarily sensitive and respectful for the different devolution settlements and understanding of the pressures and circumstances that we're under. But it can be very difficult for them to fully understand the nuances of the different settlements. My experience, and I better not think of giving examples, is the sometimes the hostility I've seen between UK government departments to each other is way in excess of any feelings of antipathy that I had in my dealings. So again, we need to recognise that that Whitehall is a beast. It's a large set of different organisations all working together in a way that the Scottish, Welsh and the previous Northern Ireland administrations didn't have to deal with. So my personal experience is actually has been positive, although, as I say, I can't speak for more recent times. I certainly was a believer, and Philip can tell me whether he agrees with this is still the case, is actually both Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland actually did better out of dealings with the UK government than the English regions did. There was more of a recognition of the separate nature of the administrations, and sometimes we actually did better than they did. So the challenges are undoubtedly there. Going back to Sarah Boyack's first question, really, of recognising the difficulties that there are, what can be done about it? Observing, again, Professor McEwen's evidence of the number of times that the dispute resolution processes through ministerial interventions has been triggered is relatively few. Indeed, in my time, it was fewer still. And the only real engagement was GMCE because of EU membership. So the referral to dispute resolution doesn't seem to provide an incentive for civil servants to work more closely together. It does lead me to the question of whether parliamentary scrutiny, the prospect, if they don't cooperate, of having to come and answer to parliamentarians to explain why things have gone wrong and haven't worked as well as they ought to be. That may, as much as anything, provide a cultural incentive to get it right in the first place. It may be that the parliamentary committees don't end up having to ask a huge number of questions. It depends on the circumstances. But the fact that you could be called to committee in a much more structured and developed way to explain why you've allowed certain things to happen and why intergovernmental cooperation hasn't worked may end up providing an incentive, because it seems to me there isn't really an incentive just now to make this work. And it's the question of whether these backdrop potentials to do so could encourage better behaviours, because trust and culture are very hard to develop. And just a last point on trust. The trust thing is something that I think is very difficult for civil servants. There's a sort of institutional inertia and some very legitimate reasons why information can't be shared. And I, as a lawyer, obviously had that issue in knowing what I could share in terms of legal advice, not least for fear of breaching legal professional privilege in those discussions. So, again, civil servants need, I think, clear guidance as to what they can share. But the transparency and trust issue, the reason why it's so important is it's not only in relation to the discussion between civil servants, but it does seem to me that if there isn't what I describe as a controlled measure of scrutiny, say by a parliament, of information within government, then the risk is you get a less controlled examination. And I give the example of the COVID WhatsApp leaks of the past week into an environment that, in some ways, a less good sense, is not a controlled way in which information gets out to the public. And it does seem to me that it's all the more important that the Parliament thinks about ways in which, in a more controlled environment, proper scrutiny to take place, because the alternative is a less controlled environment where these matters could be dealt with and looked at in ways that they may create their own challenges, if I could put it like that.
Okay. I'm very conscious of time, so if we could try and be a bit more concise going forward, that would be really helpful. Professor Gallagher.
I was expecting you to say that in the paper you've given us some really practical examples as to how to do that parliamentary scrutiny.
Yes.
So I think it's very much worth us looking at that potentially after today. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Over to Jim Gallagher.
I'll be brief, or at least concise. First, I do think it is now necessary for us to make some very substantial statutory changes to constitutionalise the relationships that have not gone well. It seems to me that, and Hugh and I are not absolutely on the same page here, but I do agree that intergovernmental relations need to be statutory. They need to be an obligation. They should, in my view, be in the within the framework of an obligation of cooperation, as they were in the EU, in the obligation of sincere cooperation, which is aspirational but nevertheless important. Second, the intergovernmental structure should be supported by a secretariat which has a degree of agency of its own, which is independent of the governments, which can set agendas and call meetings, and in extremis do something about unresolved issues. Third, all of this ought to be overseen properly by Parliament, and in particular by a reformed second chamber of the Westminster Parliament, whose job that will be. And that bundle of changes, alongside some others, it seems to me, would address the structural questions that we have to address. I think Hugh is right, however, to talk about the cultural questions that need to be addressed. And when one looks at the changing cultures, is very difficult. And changing cultures is all, as Paul hinted, about incentives. And part of the reason, leaving aside the politics, which are pretty poisonous at times, leaving aside the personalities, of which I'll say nothing, nevertheless, one of the structural reasons that the IGR with the devolved has been difficult is that 85% of the UK doesn't participate in them. England is very, very centralised, and Whitehall seeks to be the micromanager of 85% of the country, and funnily enough, it finds it quite difficult to pay hands off for the remaining 15. So a change in the governance of England is an essential precondition for effective IGR for the rest of the UK. And that's why I've certainly been working on proposals for precisely that. So that's the structural and the cultural. Just a word or two about the civil service, very quickly. I'm old enough to remember the transition, as indeed Philip is, and I think you too, from the pre-devolution civil service to the post-devolution civil service. And there was much talk at the time of the civil service as part of the glue that was going to help the machinery stick together, it was going to make it work. And that was true. It was the case. And to a substantial degree, those bits of IGR which have worked have been part of that inheritance of cross-departmental, cross-governmental working among civil servants. GMCE is a very good example of that, which Paul mentioned. However, people change, personalities change, and we have failed managerially, I think, to do what we always used to do, which is substantial interchange between the London administrations and the Cardiff, Edinburgh, and historically it was different in relation to Belfast. Certainly in Edinburgh, people from the Scottish Office and Scottish Administration expected, some of them at least, to spend some time in Whitehall learning the ropes. Didn't go so much in the opposite direction, to be fair, but we need to reinstate a dose of that. That's a managerial thing that we could be doing. So this problem is fixable, but it requires something constitutional, change in England, and managerial effort to make it all work.
Thanks very much. That's really good because it's like things that we can have a look at. And Philip Rycroft, you mentioned one or two of these things. I think you mentioned regions in England. Do you have any reflections on how do you fix where we've got to post-Brexit?
Yeah, there's a lot has been said that I agree with. The word that you used, the original question around incentives, is absolutely right. If you look at this from a Whitehall perspective, and I will speak now, from a Whitehall perspective, if we're honest about it, devolved matters is not high on the list of priorities for most Whitehall departments. There was a reality to devolve and forget. It was like, well, that's devolved. We don't need to worry about this. And so an ingrained habit, therefore, of not doing the learning, putting in the necessary effort to understand politics, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, to understand how you build good, constructive, proactive relationships across the UK. I think there's a long, long history of that. It goes back in many ways pre-devolution and is an inheritance that I, as somebody mentioned, worked hard to try and address with a little bit of success, but not totally. So, but that is buttressed, I think, by the political incentives here. For most English MPs, what's going on in the State of the Union will not be top of the list of things that they have to deal with in their constituency's surgery. You don't get, it seems to be very, very often, a sort of an upwelling of political voice in Westminster, which then runs straight to Whitehall, to say this ought to be higher up the list of priorities. This ought to be a bigger concern for the government of the day. And that's the reality that I faced when I was advising ministers. So what did I say to the ministers I worked for in terms of, in a sense, improving their incentives to get this right? My argument was that ultimately you as ministers are interested in the future of this union, the sustainability of this union. In order to achieve that, you have to approach these issues from a position of respect, the word that you use, respect for the devolved governments, people of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, their interests in the UK. And from that, you take an approach of reasonableness into the concepts of intergovernmental relations and all the rest of it. So ultimately, it came down to, or comes down to, political choice as to what substance you put into the form. I agree that we need to change the form. I think the recent reform of intergovernmental relations takes us in the right direction. I think we could go further on that. But unless the spirit, if you like, of respect and reasonableness and collaboration infuses those institutions, then they won't function. So, as I say, ultimately, it comes down to political choice. My argument to the ministers I worked for was, if you wish to sustain this union, have to show respect, because that is the way to ensure that people in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland see value in the union for the future. I think that view, clearly there's been a change in that in terms of the political holding of the UK government since I left. But I think what we were seeking to do through 2016 Scotland Act, the 2017 Wales Act and so on, remains valid and true if people are interested in sustaining the union for the future.
Can we take questions from Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, Convener. We've touched on some of this, but I just wonder your thoughts on the requirement or otherwise for the role of the civil service to be revised in light of devolution in a post-EU environment. And in the context of this, committees, parliamentarians are facing capacity issues, yet we have a duplication of effort. So, for example, I met with the UK government minister around my dog theft bill. The minister said that the department had done extensive work and suggested sending a briefing to me on the issue, which for most people would think is a reasonable course of action. UK civil servants said that wouldn't be appropriate and they would send it to the Scottish Government, who would then pass it on to me. But over a year later, I still don't have the briefing. So in the context of all of this, is there a way in which we could avoid duplication of effort, utilise the experience and expertise, even to a limited extent, of the civil service via committees, perhaps with redacted or withheld content? And I just wonder your thoughts on how we work smarter.
Okay. Mr.
Kiquette,
do you want to come in first?
Thanks. I mean, certainly the benefits of smarter working are undoubtedly clear. I mean, to a certain extent, I just wonder whether Jim's point really addresses that, is to get a kind of a broader experience of civil servants within different administrations. It's something I think that the Brown Commission looked at in looking to ensure that there are different skills of different people that come into the civil service and other opportunities for civil servants to work in private firms and the like, to get a kind of broader sense of different perspectives. The drawback to a certain extent is just the practical one of how do you operate a civil service in that way if members of a particular department are seconded for a sufficiently long period of time to make it worthwhile. It's unfortunate, that experience that you had there. Hopefully that's not too typical. Again, one of the differences that's happened over time with the Scottish Civil Service is that it's moved over time as more operational functions have come to the Scottish Government in areas of social security and the like, and a larger proportion over time of Scottish civil service time is spent in operational delivery times, and that probably has meant, with limited resources, that there's been a kind of shrinking of the time that's able to be spent dealing with policy developments. I think it is quite challenging, but I suspect the best I could say is ensuring that there's better recruitment from a wider range of experience, but also to continue the work. I know a lot of the work has been done to recruit from as much of a diverse range of society as can be. Obviously, Scottish Government civil servants, they are representative of Scotland, so they should be representative of all parts of Scotland and a diverse Scotland as well. And I know work has been done and has been a strong commitment towards that. And that I think probably would actually help. There's a degree to which there's sort of cultures amongst civil servants that are kind of in some ways not entirely typical or representative of society as a whole, and maybe a kind of broader intake would encourage a sort of bottom-up approach to better decision-making, better engagement.
Thanks, Paul. That's very helpful. Would any of the rest of the panel just come,
yeah, very quickly on this. It's a long time since I was a civil servant at St Andrew's House. It's more than a decade. But your question reminded me of rather longer ago, when the Constitutional Convention was running, which led to the creation of the Parliament. And there was some ambiguity in people's minds about the difference between Parliament and government. And it was a bit of a rude shock to many enthusiasts when they found that the civil service worked really just for the ministers. I think we have to accept that that's the constitutional position. Civil servants don't work for the Parliament. However, there are two elements to however. The first is that my recollection certainly of the early years, and Sarah Boyack will remember this as well, was of a greater degree of coming and going than perhaps your story illustrates, partly because it would be mandated and permitted by the ministers, and partly maybe the civil service felt itself a little more self-confident then than it does now. I think the key thing for officials is to understand their boundaries with the ministers, what the ministers will permit them to do, and to have the capacity and the confidence, therefore, to be able to engage probably informally with parliamentarians, but inside the boundaries of their accountability to ministers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can
I invite Mr. Ruskell, please?
Thanks very much. It has been a very insightful and very candid session with you all this morning, and I just wanted to go back to retained EU law for a moment. I mean, I think, Sir Rycroft, you talked about the bill seeking to do the impossible, but I guess we are where we are, and, Mr. Gallagher, you were talking about the options and perhaps the imagination that needs to be applied now from administrations and the House of Lords in terms of the way forward. I'd just like your brief reflections, though, on what might have been a better way forward in terms of revising and making decisions about retained EU law. I mean, I guess even within the current bill, there has been an effective carve-out around financial services. There are issues there around cliff edge and perhaps phased examination of retained EU law. I'd be interested in your brief comments about what would have been a better, more credible way forward on this. Can I start with Philip, please?
Yeah, sure. In a way, the answer to your question was we built that into the original Withdrawal Act. So if you think the construct of that, taking onto the UK statute book, EU law as it then stood, was precisely because we recognised that it was not possible to revise all of that law in the timetable that we were looking at for exit. So the concept has already been alluded to was, okay, fine, ultimately the UK Parliament, devolved parliaments, can seek to change that law, but that should be a process that happens over time with due diligence, due process, due consultation. And so that's what we were anticipating, frankly, civil servants in Whitehall, that that's the process that, would kick in. So let's take one concrete example. If you look at the Habitats Directive, there's been a lot of criticism that it overprotects some species that are common in the UK, but rare in the rest of the EU. A perfectly legitimate issue for parliaments to look at, to consider whether that law needed adjusted in a way that was better fitted to nature conservation in the UK. But you can see that sort of is quite controversial with people, kicks up lots of different interests, lots of experts out there, a sort of process that in normal course you would say would take 2 or 3 years, consultation, developing a proposition, and then going through a process. That's good lawmaking. That's good regulation, and that's what we envisaged would happen. The fact that it has been so accelerated, as has been as we've said already, is not about good regulation. It's not about better regulation. It's not about good lawmaking. It is being driven by other imperatives. So we should have some confidence that we know how to make good laws, and those are the processes we should follow.
I think, in a way, you identified the answer when you put the question, because you have the carve-out of financial services. Why was that carve-out taking place? Because there was a review going on of financial services regulation. It seems to me that historically there's a category of retained EU law, but actually EU law, or this retained EU law, falls into a whole series of different boxes, as it were. And as each box comes up for review, that's when you look at the retained EU law alongside the purely domestic law, and then you do the reform. It doesn't seem to me there's a category of retained EU law that requires review and reform all at once.
Then no cliff edge date, because you spoke earlier on about the somewhat dubious nature of, yes, of the significance of particular cliff edge dates. Is it sensible to have a cliff edge or not?
I honestly don't think it is. I think the question for ministers in any administration is which areas of law do you wish to review, to reform, and they set those tasks for civil servants. They say, we want to legislate on this within the terms of our current parliament or our current mandate. The civil servants will then review the law from wherever it derives relating to that matter. But ultimately, it is a matter for ministers to decide the priorities that they give to the areas of law for which they think reform is appropriate.
My view is it's not necessary. I think there's a kind of almost a fallacy that something has come originally from EU law means that once we're no longer in the EU, it has no relevance anymore. It changes in its relevance because the single market enforcement doesn't work in the same kind of way. But if you look at areas of law such as procurement or competition or state aids, although they are derived originally from EU law, they are areas of law that still have a relevance in a post-EU environment. Procurement, for example, there are good policy reasons why you have rules of procurement for sector competitiveness, for transparency. You'd have those laws even if we weren't had never been in the EU. So I think that the idea that because it is derived from that, it therefore needs necessarily to be reviewed, I think is a false assumption. The laws should be reflected on and considered and amended as our circumstances change. But to me, I don't see why the cliff edge is the way that has to go about it. It's all part of a normal process of development and keeping the law up to speed and up to pace with societal needs.
Yep.
Just imagine, convener, if this parliament concluded that any legislation in a devolved matter which had been passed by Westminster was automatically repealed and had to be replaced by legislation here. What would people say to you? This is a crazy idea.
Mr. Ruskell, can we move to Ms. Minto? Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Minto.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel. Yesterday, as you all know, was International Women's Day, and I was speaking in the chamber, and I said that I think that looking back and learning is essential to moving forward. And I think you've given us a lot of evidence about your experience in the civil service, which has been absolutely fascinating. And I was struck by one of the phrases, assertive muscular unionism, that apologies, I didn't write down who said it. But I'm interested to hear your thoughts on, is there anything in the way that the Windsor framework came about that can be learnt from with regards to moving forward post-devolution? And also, is there anything we can learn from Norway or Switzerland and the way that they are constructed as a way to improve relationships across parliaments and governments in the United Kingdom?
Mr. Kikett, yes.
First, your observation about International Women's Day yesterday does make me reflect. You've got four men in front of you this morning, but I think echoing what's been said earlier on, I think I would just stress the importance of discussion, negotiation. You know, it's remarkable what can be achieved. It's interesting in looking at the ways in which problems are solved in innovative ways. And I'm thinking of Sarah Boyack with a planning background. I'm thinking of charrettes and the ways in which, in that local planning sense, one of the ways in which problems can be solved is asking people from a different perspective to imagine they were pursuing the opposite point. So if you've got somebody who's supporting cycling lanes, how would you solve the shortage of houses? So how do you solve each other's problems? And only through that dialogue and discussion is that possible. So it certainly can be done if safe environments can be found to allow those discussions. And again, recent progress on a number of these fronts, which may open doors in other areas that were perhaps either closed or only ajar, may well be opened up and allowed to be progressed.
Thank you.
If I could add to that, I think one of the lessons of the Windsor framework, a strange name, is that you fix things when you focus on the practical rather than when you focus on the conflicting principles involved. Lots of institutions have got conflicting principles, conflicting objectives. And you can either hit each other over the head with your principles, or you can sit down and work through in practice what they might mean for sausage meat or whatever the policy issue of the day is. The lesson from Mr. Sunak's work, I think he deserves some credit for this, is that he sat down and worked through the detail. And worked through the detail on red lanes and green lanes and trusted traders and all that stuff, and got to a place where there's still a tension. Of course, there's a tension because you're trying to do contradictory things, being two regulatory regimes at the same time. But they found a practical way that will probably work with goodwill. And I was interested, I'm not sure Norway is quite a helpful example here, but Switzerland also is in its relationship with the EU. One of the striking things, if you go to Brussels, and you should go to Brussels, is that the largest delegation from a state in Brussels is the Swiss delegation, because they have to negotiate every wretched thing. They too have to focus on the detail. And they have been stuck with a contradictory principle problem, in that the Swiss state wanted to join and the Swiss people wouldn't let them. so they have worked their way through that in a practical kind of a way. It drives the EU mad, as it happens. Very difficult for Brussels. Nevertheless, it works in a practical sort of a way. So if one is thinking of the relationships here inside the UK, the more we spend our time grandstanding on issues of principle, the less successful we will be. Instead, we should sit down and work through issues day by day, whether it's in relation to single markets and common frameworks, or the whole other series of increasingly shared competences between the governments, to which Paul referred, social security would be an obvious example, the more we'll be successful if we actually work together and cooperate. And that's the lesson of all the external exemplars.
If we could be really concise, Dr. McCormick, thanks.
Echo, I was about to say most of what Jim said, but just to qualify slightly, the EU drives the Swissmat as well, because their view of sovereignty also matters. So, yes, practicalities matter, but I always think of George Orwell's review of Mein Kampf. People also respond to flags. John Hume famously said in Northern Ireland, you can't eat a flag, and that's part of our history and part of our peace process. But identity, there are visceral, very deeply held issues of sovereignty and identity which also need to be taken into account, and that's part of our journey. It's far from easy, but working those things through, again, it's only achievable by mutual respect and trust and building relationships. But it is yes, much better when the focus is on the practicalities, but you have to recognise the significance of identity as well.
I wonder if I could ask a final question in relation to intergovernmental relations and these issues. One of the things that has happened recently that hasn't happened in 20 years of devolution was the use of the Section 35 order by the UK government, ostensibly about the impact on the Qualities Act. UK, which includes Northern Ireland, and I think in his address to the House of Commons, Alistair Jack did say that it was about regulation across borders, but we have an open border with the with Northern Ireland and Ireland, and one of the principles of the market access they have is free movement of workers. So someone could be moving who has a certificate gained in Ireland, or indeed now Spain, when they've introduced that legislation. So keeping away from the subject matter of what's happened, do you have a reflection on what that means for devolution, the fact that that Section 35 order has been used at this stage? And I wonder. Mr. Cockett.
Yeah, I mean, I alluded to that briefly in my written submission. And the reason I did that is it does seem to me, trying very carefully to stay away from the politics and views on the policy, if the UK government has, as it's published, its statement of reasons, some 13 pages why this hasn't worked, the question that came to my mind is about intergovernmental relations, is in due course maybe questions will end up being asked as to why it was that intergovernment relations did not secure at least the addressing of some of these problems. Now is not the place to address the detail of them, but it seems likely that at least some would have been capable of resolution with a fully and better functioning intergovernmental arrangements in place. And maybe that's one of the lessons from that will be drawn. And one of the reasons why that's quite, I think, quite important is the difficulties we've been addressing here about reconciling the future in the Brexit context, you can see why they could be irreconcilable because of the distinctly different political views of the administrations. But it doesn't seem to me, if you think of the policy of gender recognition, extraordinarily sensitive and important topic, there shouldn't be the same extent of differences at that fundamental level. It goes back to Jim's question about the kind of the detail of all of this. So I think the Brexit and gender recognition contrast with each other, because you can understand why Brexit was so difficult. It's less obvious to me why we've found ourselves in a position where some, if not all, of the problems addressed in the UK government's note should not have been capable of being addressed through proper intergovernmental relations. But I better say no more than that, because it is such a sensitive and difficult topic.
I'm not going to say anything about gender recognition because I don't know enough about it. However, it was quite interesting that we all had to go scurrying to the statute book to say, Section 35, what's that?
Yeah.
Right? When one reads it, of course, it's a provision which was inserted into the draft legislation probably quite late on in its development. One can see why it is there. It's easy to say it's a terrible thing. And one can see why it's there. It's there because devolved power, devolved legislative power, is writ very wide. The test of devolved competence is wide, because it is anything that does not relate to a reserved matter, and relate to means something like is really about, is mostly about, is largely about. That means that there are certainly real possibilities that devolved legislation would have a material effect on the law in relation to reserved matters and still not be reserved. So some safety net was inevitable. Whether Section 35 is quite the right safety net is a reasonable question to ask. Is it odd that perhaps that a minister does it and that's all there is to it? But the reason it was drafted at that time, it was justified in those terms at that time, was the reason that Paul gives. The ability to wave that stick would have been an opportunity to try and resolve the issues in an IGR discussion. I was working in the Justice Department in St Andrew's House in 2004 when we did the legislation on gender recognition first time round, and we thought very carefully about the problems of cross-border and concluded actually it would be better not to have them for everyone's sake. Whether we got the substance of legislation right is a different question, but the idea that there's a risk that once gender recognition suddenly stops working when the train crosses the border is just it's unacceptable. You can't have that. So a cross-border solution that works for everyone is, once again, the right way to do this. Talk to each other.
So, right up against time, I'm really sorry, Dr. Allen. A Thursday morning committee, as you know, we're up against plenary session in the Parliament kicking in a very short number of minutes. So, can I thank you all for your submissions and for your contributions today? I'm sure the committee have all found it fascinating, and the candour and the information we've been able to glean from this will help us in our deliberations going forward. So thank you very much again. And on that note, I suspend this session of the Parliament.